It's -9 and sunny outside. It's a cool day. It's not terribly cold, but it's cool. A little bit too cool for me to sit outside because it's going to bother my ears. I got nothing to cover my ears. I got a hat to put on, but it doesn't cover my ears. So I'm not going out there. I'm going to stay in. Would have been nice to get out, but that's life. One of these days when it warms up, I'm going to go down to the Rainbow Bench, and I'm going to vlog from the Rainbow Bench. I've got an interesting story about the Rainbow Bench. It was already there, but there was a program where the city said you could paint the bench. Anything that was public friendly, as long as you take care of it, for as long as your business is still there. So the Rainbow Retro secondhand store took it over, which is run by the GLCR. No, that's in Regina. I forget the name of it, the organization, but it's a gay and lesbian organization in town here that for the most part deals with transgender rights and transgender issues, because that's the thing in society that's still not very equal. The rest of the LGBTQ+ rainbow seems to be accepted by society, but trans people, still not so much. Even in the gay community, there's transphobia. So, you know. Anyways, they painted the bench Gay Pride Rainbow, and it's beautiful. But they got some slack at city council one day from a woman who used to be able to stand up before COVID. You could stand up and petition the government, the city council, to do things. And she wanted the bench painted green, like the other benches. And here's the folly of this one. She leads off with, "I'm not homophobic, but," which is a pretty good key she's homophobic. In the first place, yeah. So she's going on about being a historian. Okay, that's the best part, right? About being an historian, and historically the benches were painted green. And all I had to think about her is she's only seen a few benches then, because even just on Main Street, the benches are not all green. Some of them are black, and some of them are brown. This is the way the city has painted them, and they're not all green. The newest ones are green, actually. The ones before that were black, and the ones even before that were brown. That's just the way they bought them, and that's the way they stayed for many, many years. So, you know, so much for your historian thing. And traditionally, if you went back before this round of benches even existed, the original benches that were in the city were supposedly black. This goes back to the 1940s. And they were black, the downtown benches, all of them. So much for your historian thing. Me thinky, just like everyone else thinky, you are a homophobic person who is pissy that they put up a Gay Pride Rainbow downtown. Yeah. Of course, this is a community because we went a very long time without any rain, which is usual for a semi-arid area. If you look up the weather patterns in Moose Jaw, you will find out we are classed as a semi-arid area, which means we don't get a lot of rain. And which means there's a long period of time between rains sometimes. And that's exactly what happened after the Gay Pride March, the Gay Pride Parade went on. And of course, these wackadoodles were going on that they caused it not to rain because God was punishing our community. Because we allowed them to march. Can you say wackadoodle? I mean, holy cow. Yeah, just unbelievable. But for the vast majority of people, I'm talking like 95% of the community, they are completely accepting of the LGBTQ community. So it's just amazing that there's still these wackadoodles willing to speak out publicly, because the rest of the society, the vast majority of them, look at them like they're crazy at best, and some of them will actually speak out against them. So, you know, it's just bizarre. My last phone number seems to have been given out to creditors by a person's by the name of Mr. and Mrs. Orange. They had racked up debt, and the debt had been sold to a debt collector. So you know what happened? Even though it wasn't their phone number, that's what they gave out was mine. They gave out my phone number all over the city, in fact. I had forgotten my card for the points card at the Sobeys, not Sobeys, whatever it is. I had forgotten my points card, so I gave them my phone number, and they said, Mr. Orange. And I said, no, Mr. Nicholson. And she looked again, and she says, well, we got two people under that phone number. And I'm like, yes, and one of them's lying. I don't know why they were giving out my phone number, but probably just made it up at random. That's what I figure, because there would have been no way they would have known me. The phone number was unlisted, so, you know. Yeah. Anyways, it's not like I knew these people. Anyways, I was getting calls from debt collectors for these people, and I'm going, there is no Mr. and Mrs. Orange here. My name is Nicholson. You have the wrong number. This went on for about 2 months, and I had the hell enough of these people. So I finally literally yelled into the receiver, into the phone. This was a landline, by the way, so telephone, you know. I literally yelled into it, I don't know who the hell these people are, but if I ever find them, I'm going to kill them and send you their heads in the mail. Then I hung up and I phoned the police and I said, you know, I'm getting harassed by these people, and I'm not the Mr. and Mrs. Orange and all this stuff. And at that point in time, a lot of the cops knew me personally. So they, that's not so true anymore, because most of the cops that knew me back then are retired or dead of old age. So, but then they knew me, and they helped set up a restraining order against the company to stop phoning me. So yeah, I had to go to court for that, but it was a very short thing. All I had to do was stand up and say a few things that I can't remember, and I was done, basically. Signed a form, and they couldn't phone me anymore. So, yep, it solved that one. Being that I'm absolutely not the person they're looking for, so, you know. Yeah. Ah, you betcha. Back in the 1990s, we went down the wrong road. We were miles away from the road we were supposed to turn down to get to a event that was being held in a farm. Now, I thought this was the road. I honestly did. I had written down the directions wrong, and me and my friend ended up at the end of a road that had ended in a salt marsh. I don't know if you know what a salt marsh is, but it's basically a salt water body of salt water, and it's quite spectacular looking because for thousands of feet beyond where the road had stopped being a road, there's this salt bed. And little bit patches of water here and there because it was a very dry year, and there wasn't the water wasn't there anymore for the most part. One of the lakes, actually Old Wives Lake, is dry, was completely dried up. I've got a photo of myself and a friend standing in front of Old Wives Lake. It was supposedly in the background there, but there's nothing there. It's completely dried up. So there's just this big empty basin behind us. We purposely went out there to take pictures of ourselves with the dried up lake because it had never happened in our lifetimes. It was just so dry that year. Anyways, of course, this was before the time I started carrying around a camera with me. This was in the 90s, so there was no digital camera, and I had not started to carry a camera around with me in general into a photo camera, you know, with film, right? For a few years after that, I really wish, because I don't know where this is anymore, and if I did, I would try and get out there and take some photos because it was a very unique to our landscape. This sort of thing just doesn't exist very often in Saskatchewan, so it would be enjoyable to get some photos of it. Anywho, that's it. That's all. You have a fabulous day and keep smiling.